Welcome to the debrief. It's Dave O'Neill with my COVID edition. We'll get straight into it because he's on the line. Normally I ring him, but he's right here. He's in the UK. It's Ray Badran.
Good morning, Dave. Good evening. Good morning or good evening, whatever.
Yeah. You're in London. Yeah.
Yeah, I am. It's 7 a.m. It's 7:30 in the morning here, and it's, what, it's 4:30 for you?
Then what, so you get up early, do you, Ray?
Yeah, my wife goes to work, so I have to, you know, that's why it's a bit running around this morning.
She's a teacher, so...
Yeah, she goes, that's why I avoid saying she goes to school. Sometimes sounds a bit wrong. Well, she's got to pack my wife's lunch for school.
Regular listeners will know that when I was in the UK last year, I caught up with you and had a great tour.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
we established that you drag your wife away from the ideal beach school job to the misery of London for your career.
Yeah. And the tables have quite turned at the moment, actually, because, you know, she's had a promotion and she's earning quite good money, and our whole industry is sort of crumbling down. So I'm sort of just catering to her every need at the moment while she pays the rent.
But what is going on in London, like, in terms of are people going out, or the pubs are closing early, aren't they?
So here's the timeline, what happened. It hit pretty badly. The government didn't take it seriously, didn't do anything, much like a lot of the sort of big right-wing governments around the world didn't do anything. It hit pretty badly, very badly, very early. Then they were like, all right. Then we had 3 months of, like, the world's harshest lockdown. Like, so what you guys had in Melbourne, but give an extra month, straight off the top, like, pretty much, bar, like, a week of COVID going rampant. And that was hard to deal with. That was hard mentally. Like, imagine, I mean, obviously it would have been hard doing that then, but yeah. And so it was just that, but a little bit longer and straight away. And sort of New Zealand was opened at this point, and Australia were opening, and it was like, what the fuck's going on here? Then the numbers went down a lot, and it looked like the lock-ins really worked. And then so they just not only opened up, they opened up with, like, a vengeance to try.
I saw the photos of Bournemouth Beach and stuff. Hundreds of people.
They encouraged everyone to go out. They encouraged everyone to go overseas again. They did a thing, a scheme. They did a scheme in, and I'm, this sounds insane, but they did. So for all of August and part of September, you got 50% off at any meal going out in any meal across London. So the government reimbursed every restaurant, cafe, pub, anywhere. So 50% off meal and non-alcoholic drink up to, so. It was just full. It was just full, and the summer hit, so everyone went out, and they were trying to boost the economy. And then now the second wave's hit, and they're like, "Are we going to have a second lock in?" No, but they sort of put all these curfews in, and it's sort of this weird time where it's like halfway between life is normal with, like, these restrictions,
and that are
sort of really, really been hammered in now, like quite normal, to be honest.
Do people wear masks on the street, or?
Yeah, without a question. It's not even
You have to.
You don't, not on the street, but in venues you do. Inside you do. And on public transport you do. But that's been going on for four months. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's slightly different. I mean, I don't really know enough about it, but it's slightly different in the sense of, I think, like, you know, they can't contain the virus here anymore. It's too big.
Yeah, it's got out, hasn't it?
It got out straight away, so they need to sort of have sort of some. I don't know. I don't know really.
Do you feel scared when you go out and stuff? And
no, not of the virus. I mean, I suppose, like, I think I've had it, and I've known people that have had it and stuff like that. And, you know, you read enough about it, and you think you've had it. Well, I had a really bad flu at the beginning of it all. And my borough is the second worst borough in London for coronavirus. It's like 152 cases a day or something like that.
Wow.
You know, I've got friends, close friends that have had it. Know about five comedians that have had it. A lot of people that have had it, though, like, didn't really notice it that bad. But I did have a bad flu then. I did have a bad flu that knocked me around for about a week, so.
And how did it affect, I mean, I heard you on, it must have been the Dum Dum Club, talking about your club that you started at the top of your flats or whatever, where you all socialise?
Well, yeah, so we weirdly became, like, I mean, I think this is a common story, but, like, our building's got to be unique. I've just become friends with all the neighbours, become friends with each other, and we meet up in the courtyard. And then so...
Did the Rona spread there, you reckon, or?
Oh, possibly. I mean, you know, the 3 months of lockdown was tough, like, you know, yeah. and the public here are not as, like, compliant with the rules and stuff like that because the government's been so reckless and, like...
Yeah.
You also, they break the fucking rules and then we're locked in and stuff like this as well. And it's just like...
Yeah, so Boris Johnson's mate, his advisor, he was driving around and visiting
people. Well, yeah, so, yeah, and it's like... you know, look, I stayed fucking locked in for 3 months and just hung out with the neighbours in this building. I mean, you know, that was it. And one point I tried to... you know, I did. I found it really tough mentally. Because I came over here, you know, as we chatted last time, you know,
yeah.
I'd only just recently came here and things had just started going well for me in the last like 6 months or something like that.
Yeah,
and really, really started to go well at work wise and have these sort of big opportunities. And they just all just sort of, the whole scene disappeared. Like, and then there was a backlog. So I had like a script. With this place, with this production company, this cool production company that I really like, and like all the staff get laid off from there, you know, and I'm like, oh, maybe, you know, and then there's a backlog of big comedians, really famous comedians pitching things and stuff like this, so your stuff just gets lost, and you know, and then like the whatever little market there was is left is just eating up, and like everyone's writing.
So, well, it's true because you see, like, David Tennant and that other really famous bloke are doing a show filmed in their homes. So what hope is there for you if David Tennant
gets... Totally. And then, and then, like, your management agency, they're losing staff and those people have to work with, like, you know, the bigger comedians and stuff like that and put their resources where the money's coming in and stuff like that, where they can still get money, I suppose, and stuff. So, I felt it and I sort of... I mean, this is quite a funny story. I don't know if you should say. I can say this actually. I don't know where this is at. This project. So I shouldn't really.
We'll just be vague. I shouldn't really talk.
Okay. Well, Kitty Flanagan has a TV show coming out in Australia, I believe.
Yeah. That's been in the papers. I do a podcast with Kitty. Yeah, it's called Entitled.
Yeah. Yes. Okay.
And they've delayed the film. Voice.
You do it, so I don't really know, but this is more. It's more about my personal story within this, not Kitty's project. It's
Did you have a part in it?
I know. Well, this is part of my mental breakdown and all this stuff as well. So right, so I'm going. Things are going well over here in London. I'm with this agency over here. There's quite a good agency, and they represent me over here, and they've put the last year and a bit into developing me or whatever. But I've also got a management agency in Australia, and I've somehow organised this, right? And now the agency in Australia gets in touch and they say, Kitty Flanagan's written a part for you in her show. And I'm like, what the fuck? I don't even know. I don't really know Kitty. And I'm so flattered beyond. And I heard this from a writer about a year or a bit ago. It was like, oh, Kitty Flanagan's written a part with you based in mind in the show. And I'm like, this is fucking...
Right.
This is unbelievable. When I heard it 2 years ago, I thought the guy was crazy because I didn't really, I don't, well, I've only met Kitty like twice, I think, and I was like pretty shy when I met her, and I've got a massive fan and stuff. And but you know, she's sort of, I mean, you're mates with her, but for me, she was someone that kind of kept to herself, and like I didn't really know her.
She always was, though. Well. She always was.
Yeah, she'd kind of duck in and do a spot sometimes, like, you know, a drop-in spot at the comedy store here and there, like, but then she just like, you know, kind of leave and like, and so yeah, there was an air of mystery about it, and then so I get this offer, and I'm like, I still don't believe it's true when I get the offer for the part, and then I read the part, and it's called Ray Gruber, and the part, the character description is me, right? And I'm like, this is fucking excellent, this is fucking unbelievable, right? This is so cool. Just to be offered it, I was so flattered, right? And then, I mean that in the most like humble way, just because I haven't got that much stuff in my career and stuff like that, and to get something like that was really, really cool. And out of nowhere sort of thing as well. But at the same time, things were going for me really, well here as well. But nothing's taken off yet, right? But things are going really well here. And this filming for this part is right over July, August this year was meant to be, right? When Edinburgh Fringe is on, and my management agency's put money into me doing Fringe, paid for fucking posters, promoters, all this stuff, blah, blah, blah. And so I go tell them I want to go back and do this thing, and they're like pretty upset straight away. And they're like, oh, pretty annoyed. Like, not like they want my best interest, but they're like, why are we wasting? Like, they already had a reservation about signing someone from overseas, and I sort of pushed for it to happen. And then now I'm making everything they say, like, just, you know. And they're like, oh, so they're like, he's just going to move back to Australia pretty much. We've spent this money on him and helped him and now wasted our time for the last year. They weren't saying this, but they were expressing this, you know?
Yeah, sure.
And they were like, all right. And they really didn't want me to go. They were like, we really think you should do Edinburgh in your long-term future. This is your long-term future. So I go to do this part, right? And I go to get this, and I think it's like a read for this part because this writer's told me this, but it's an audition. And I go there. Right? And I'm just, so I've got all this shit. I'm not really meant to go back to Australia to do it. I don't really know. It's all a bit crazy. And plus, day to day, I'm quite busy as well. I'm traveling around and doing gigs and stuff like this. So I do this read, and I go there, and I don't have a script, and I'm realizing, and I'm like, oh, fuck, here, this is, I mean, I just realized how bad it was. It was just me and the camera and this person that wasn't an actor doing the read, just doing the other lines. And it was really bad. And I left, and I was like, fuck, mate, that was embarrassing. Why did I, you know, what have I done here? But I kind of was like, oh, I wasn't going to do it anyway, you know? Like, that made the decision for me, you know, and I'll just move forward. Then coronavirus hits, right?
Yeah.
And I'm like, fucking 2 days later, I'm like, oh, no, Edinburgh's going to be cancelled. I see this is the only bit of work, actually, I can actually possibly do now this whole year, this and the writing job I've got. So I'll just have to, I have to get this part. So I'm like, this is insane. So I get ahead of it, like, and I email saying, I know this is the worst audition ever. Can I please re-audition? And I email my agency saying, can you email this, forward this on for me? And they forward it through, and the people say, well, they say, they pretty much say, there's no point in sending another audition. or something like that. There's no point. But I was like, then fucking coronavirus really hit, and like it was like, you know, people are saying crazy shit. And I'm like, oh my God, I've just got to get this part. So I'm like, I'll just do another audition. So I learned the lines, and I do a self-tape, and I send it to them despite them saying anything, right?
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh, I don't hear back anything. And then I'm like, maybe I'll email Kitty. I don't really know Kitty, but maybe I'll email Kitty. And so I email Kitty, right? And I just write a really nice email saying, hey, Kitty, I just want to apologize for the really bad audition, and I want to say I'm really flattered that you thought of me and blah, blah, blah. And she wrote back saying, hey, Ray, thanks for getting so much in touch. I didn't know it. You know, she wrote me a really nice email back saying that, you know, the first audition was really bad, but the second audition was good. And I didn't get the part due to them casting someone else in another role, and it didn't fit. So it wasn't to do with the audition and stuff like that. So that made me feel quite good. She goes, but I'm going to write you another small role. You know, that you don't have to audition for anyway. I was like, great. And then I'm like, but so what? So someone else going to play Ray, and I'm going to play this. I'm going to play someone else. No? Look, someone playing Ray, and then I'm playing. Am I going to be acting? Do you know, does this other person want to come hang out with me for 2 weeks and get into character for a little bit? But and then so then I couldn't even get that other, you know, then travel's cut off and all that, and then I couldn't even get I couldn't even get that, you know?
Well, that, so, they haven't filmed it yet, though. There's still hope for you, right?
I know, there is still hope for me. And the irony being is I got my... I mean, I'm talking a lot about my work opportunities here, so I really hope I don't sound...
No, I don't sound like
I'm boasting, because I'm talking about this as someone that's quite needy and doesn't have much work, really. But I got my first UK TV spot here, right? Just about 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago.
Fantastic.
And it comes out. But the irony being is if
on
I
what show,
pay,
though? On what show?
The Jonathan Ross Comedy Club. It's a comedy club.
Oh, fantastic.
Club. Yeah. So it's on this Saturday. I don't know when this comes out, but it's on...
Where's that on broadcast in England? What station is that on?
It's called Television, David. It's called we call it Television over here. It's ITV.
Oh, that's big.
Yeah. It's on after... And now they've got a curfew, making everyone has to be inside after 10 p.m. This show's on 10:30. Perfect.
And have you done it already?
Yeah, I've done it, yeah.
And how'd it go? Yeah.
Went pretty well, I think so. Yeah, you know. It's hard to tell when you do like those things, you know?
Yeah.
It's more about how you look playing to the camera, you know what I mean? Like I've done three, and I reckon the best one I ever did with the best gig I ever had was the first one, but I didn't. And then the second one I was like, I'm just gonna play to the cameras and look really good here. And that one looks, because they just put the laughs the same on everyone's thing anyway.
Yeah.
You know?
Was there an audience?
Just take my laughs and give it to everyone else anyway. Yeah, there was an audience of 50 social distance people wearing masks.
Oh, that's hard.
They make a thing of it. It's like a thing. And the
things,
I tell you what, people are very keen to go out and excited to go out.
Yes.
So that counterbalances the mask. You know, they're laughing a bit extra hard. So there is the audiences have been quite lovely coming back, to be honest.
So you're back doing live gigs, are you?
I am. But just to wrap up that story with that TV spot. So if I had gone back to do the movie, and if it was going on, the TV series, and if it was going, I would have missed the TV spot, you know?
There you go.
So they were right. The agency were kind of maybe right. I don't even... But none of this actually happened because COVID's happened. So who knows?
Did you meet Jonathan Woss? Did you meet
him? Yeah, I did. Yeah.
Nice. What was he like?
He was like someone that's been in show business for like 40 years, you know?
You're doing a gesture of a mask. You're doing a gesture of a barrier. Yeah.
Yeah. I met David Hasselhoff once at the Sydney Opera House Sydney Comedy Festival did something where they made him, they got him, God. He was in town, and they got him to sing a song at the end of the gala at the Opera House. Right?
He'd be the same, wouldn't he?
Yeah. He was the most celebrity I've ever met as human being in my life. Like not human, just so used to having to talk to people in like a certain way that for like 50, 60 years or whatever. Yeah, it's just couldn't be a human, yeah.
And so what live gigs are you doing now? Like, what's happening there?
I'm just, like, there's a couple of comedy clubs. Most of them are starting to open in October, I believe. So, like, in the next few days. And they just sort of open socially distanced and.
So and normal place 150, you get 70 people in or something like that?
Probably less, but yeah, probably about 50, but yeah. So the fees are gone down and all that shit and And it has become a bit more clicky, I will say, the comedy scenes, you know.
A bit more competitive.
People look up. Well, clicky, competitive. Well, no, less competitive, but clicky. Like, people are booking, like, looking after their mates and their staples. The agencies are sort of putting their own gigs on for their people and stuff like that, you know.
Yeah,
so
right.
It's a more a mode of survival sort of thing, I suppose. I don't know.
How have the gigs been that you've done? How have they been?
They've been good. They've been good, yeah. I was watching the Premier League, and I heard the commentators say about the Premier League players, and I think this happened to me with stand-up, but they were saying you get through, like, the first few matches on adrenaline, it's exciting to come back.
Yes.
But then after that, the cracks start to show, and, like, the fitness and the time off starts to show. And I felt like the first couple back were like, I just went back, new material, riffed about like lockdown, riffed about other things. It was great. Riffed about things. And I was like, this is great. This time away has made me freer, made me better, made me more confident. It's a new race.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then about that worked for about two or three gigs. This high pressure gig that started like that, they just ate shit. And I was like, "Oh, that's right. That's why you've got bankable material. That's why you fucking, you know, that's why you work up bits and stuff."
Yeah,
it was a real professional show.
Hilsey was saying there was. I spoke to Hilsey briefly, and he said there were outdoor gigs going on. He reckons.
Yeah, the worst long running gig I saw. That was, and I can say this, I don't think we'll get back to you, it was purely run by a management agency to just make money for the acts and stuff. And I actually saw it sort of happen. And anyway, it's a drive-in gig, drive-in.
Oh, I've seen that in America, yeah.
So people, yeah. So you know that noise that we all usually associate with get fucked or get out of my way? That's the noise that you need to receive as laughter now.
So people sit in their cars and you stand on that stage outside and just deliver your stuff to their speakers.
Yeah, hope to get a few beeps.
Flash a light.
Serious. I mean, you joke, but that's how they respond. I mean, have you seen the movie Cars? Have you seen the movie Cars?
Yeah.
They do that. I've seen that without talking.
Do it in America. They're doing it in America. Monty Franklin, an Aussie who lives over there, has put photos of it up.
And well, I was watching the news. I had like 24-hour news on here when the fucking lockdown first happened, and I just remember watching all about this big thing about how different industries are adapting to the coronavirus and stuff like this and stuff. And it was one on how drive-in cinemas had taken off again in Germany. Yeah. And I was like, oh, wow, I wonder if someone would be dumb enough to do this for stand-up. And then, a month later, I just see it. And they sell out. Like, they're £50 a ticket. They're just selling out. Like, £50, like, you know, like, they're selling out. You can't put on a world-class lineup in a good theatre, like, selling out like that without, you know, like, £50. They're selling out for fucking the season of these shows.
Oh, my God. I got to ask you my questions I ask everyone. Are you ready?
Yes, please.
Because these are the lockdown questions. What was the last thing you cooked, right?
The last thing I cooked? Yeah, I am a cook. I mean, what was the last thing I cooked?
What did you have last night?
It was a stir fry. Nice. A stir fry. Nice. Yeah, pork stir fry.
Ooh, nice. What about was the last thing you watched or listened to? We've been watching
I've been watching South Park again. I mean, not again, but I've been watching South Park. I just sort of started.
They're still making
South
it,
Park.
I assume. They're still making
it. Yeah, it's so good, man. It's the best social commentary, and it's just very good. Very.
I like the way Cartman speaks. That voice, I love that voice.
I like the way how they take an observation and they make it's great sitcom like. There's just one episode I watched, the one of the characters wakes up and there's e-scooters have appeared all in the town and they don't know how the e-scooters have got there. And it sort of just starts off as this premise and they're always just a good observation though. That makes a good premise,
E-scooters. Yeah, well, they're all around the world. They've turned up everywhere. Well, not in Melbourne, they just they're trying to get into Melbourne, but they're in Adelaide.
Oh! Brisbane. I think Melbourne would be prime for them, like just the landscape of them and the landscape of the city.
Oh, you go to Paris. Everyone's on them in Paris. You get run over by them. Right.
I went to Paris for 2 weeks when the lockdown after the lockdown happened. So I've had a bit of a crazy time. So it's 3 month lockdown. I was like, oh, I've got to get out of here. My partner was just working, and she says, oh, I'm going away. I think some of the girls are going to go away to Croatia from school or something. And I was like, oh, I've been locked in for 3 months, you know, and I might go away by myself. So I went to Paris. And it was good, £60 on the train. And 2 hours, just went down there. And then I got an Airbnb, so cheap, and just in the middle of the city. Because all the Parisians usually go, they all travel to the beach for summer. So they'd all leave. No international tourists. So just like, I mean, when I say empty, I'm like a city that's gone from 9 million people to 2 million people, you know? Like, yeah. But like it's like, you know, you go to the Champs-Élysées at like 7 in the morning and you're having a coffee and there's like 3 people around, you're walking around, like, yeah. You know? Yeah, it's pretty surreal. And then I was like, what am I going to do one night? So I go to this, I look up, I wonder, I've heard about these gigs in Paris and stuff like that. And I was like, I wonder if stand-up's starting up here again. And so Paris followed a similar timeline to London, to UK as well, yeah. Where they went into lockdown, thought they beat it, went fully out again. I think the French, the Prime Minister's quote was, now go be French. He said, and they went out. They just fully went out. I couldn't believe it because we'd been in full lockdown, and we just got. And I went there, and there were gigs, and people just full 100 people in a gig, and 7 nights a week, English speaking comedy,
stand up, really?
Yeah, there's like French shows and English shows and full. And I introduced myself to this guy, and I'm chatting to him and stuff like that. And I said, can I jump up into a spot? And he goes, yeah. And I haven't done stand up like, you know, 3 or 4 months now, and like I'm also, it's also like summer, so it's like 30 something degrees, yeah. You know, and I've got holiday clothes on, and I'm like, I was
live in Paris,
I went into this spot, and we're great, and he's like, man, we don't have a headliner because Tom Rhodes is meant to be in town.
Oh, I like Tom Rhodes.
You know, he can't come around. So you want to headline all these gigs this week? So I'm like, man, I'd fucking love to headline these gigs. So, like, I just have this surreal experience where I come from, like, this apartment, lost all my work and locked down and, like, you know, going to kill my partner, going to kill each other, live on top of each other here for 3 months.
Yeah.
Get out, go to Paris. It's beautiful. The sun's out. It's shining. Everyone's out. I'm like, I get asked to be a headliner at all these gigs and I'm just going, maybe I'm meant to be here actually. Yeah. Like, I might just stay here. I had a real bit of a crisis again then. But then
you're the toast of Paris. I love it.
It was good. Yeah. And it was good. And so, yeah, that was fun. That was fun. Yeah.
Oh, great. And they laughed at your jokes. I mean, I assume it's expats and French people, but they all speak English, so
yeah. The French are a bit hard. French people, like, could you do gigs in say like Belgium, and that's a bit better because like they have to speak English, you know. So yeah. Like their English, they get to it quicker. Like the French know English, and like the people that come to the show definitely know English. Definitely like expats or English speaking or English yeah. people that live there or whatever, or French people that speak English. But there is a touch of a delay because on a daily basis they're using French every day, you know.
Sure thing.
So they're not. That
sounds great. What was the last bit of human contact you had
today?
That's my last question.
My wife's leaving to work.
Yeah, that's good.
To school. Yeah.
Wasn't your neighbours up on the balcony or whatever on the rooftop?
No, not my neighbours. We're that's the next project though. Me and the neighbours, because they're all talking about there's a possible second lockdown happening in London now. Like, cause they just put these curfews in and the numbers keep going up. And I mean, you just don't know, obviously. But like, I mean, you just don't know what the government's going to do here and stuff like that. But we're going to do a project called Scotia Building tonight, and our building, which you came to, you dropped off the front.
I remember it.
Yes. We tried to launch a podcast. It didn't really work, but we're trying to now launch a building TV show. So it's called Scotia Building Tonight, and it's a talk show for the building, by the building, in the building, Dave. And It goes through all the building news. We go through the notice board in the lobby each week, and we sort of have a guest from a various apartment on the show, on there. And yeah, we're going to put some notes on the notice board to see if anyone will come on the show. And
great,
we got a green screen. So yeah, I mean, keep an eye out for that. It's coming out.
Right, things are happening. right, Badran, ladies and gentlemen.
Thanks, Dave. Thanks, man. Lovely, always lovely talking to you.